This lecture is about Pioneer Enterprises in 3D printing. My name is Ildikó Papp from the University of Debrecen. 3D printing is one of the most innovative technologies in the field of object manufacturing. In addition to multinational companies, smaller enterprises have also an important role to play in offering popular tools and services for users. And I try to. Yes, there is a problem with my. Okay, yes. It's solved.
It's okay.
It's okay, but the. Okay. So first of all, I would like to speak about 3D printing and about the most popular 3D printing technology. And the original aim of this lecture was to overview the history and the regional role of Prusa Research Company, but another pioneer is mentioned as well. The MakerBot industries will also be discussed because of their initial similarity. Both companies were established based on the same basic ideas related to project named RepRap. Nowadays, these companies have a different role in developing of 3D printing and they meet needs of different target groups. Yes. 3D printing is one of the additive manufacturing technologies. It is a process where a physical object is made from three-dimensional digital model, typically by superimposing several thin layers of a material instead of using a molding or removing material from a larger block. Because of each object is built up uniquely, 3D printing is especially great for making unique and customized items or small series of objects. It is often used in engineering design process, creating prototypes or operational parts or assemblies, or in realization of artistic projects. 3D printing has inspired users to change dynamic of consumer culture by turning users into active creators from passive consumers. Now I would like to overview basics of filament-based 3D printing, which is the most popular technology in this field. Fused deposition modeling and fused filament fabrication are the alternative names of this filament-based 3D printing. Filament is the common name of cylindrical shaped threads made of thermoplastics. Home printers typically work with this plastic filament. In an FDM printer, a plastic filament feed through the nozzle. Here, this material is melted, liquefied, and the printhead drones on the platform where it immediately hardens again. The nozzle can move only in horizontal directions and put this melted plastic to the correct location. And when a layer is drawn, the platform lowers itself by one layer thickness, so the printer can start with the next layer. Fused deposition modeling is popularly featured in most consumer-grade desktop printers. This method of 3D printing requires a very simple setup, using only a heated nozzle, built platform, and a coil thermoplastic filament to build an object. Fused deposition modeling is more user-friendly than the other 3D printing methods, thanks to fewer working parts to connect it with. The next fact is the lower price tag. Devices and the printing materials are more affordable than the other 3D printing methods. The thermoplastic filaments are also environmentally and mechanically stable. FDM often produce objects with rougher surfaces and the final product will need some retouching. It's derived from the printing technology, so the surface of the object will show the drawings of the contours and infills and the layers. If you check this figure, you can, or this picture, you can see these plastic threads on the top surface and the side faces, side surfaces of this printed part. On any FDM printer, a wide variety of thermoplastics can be used, or some exotic filaments can be printed with relatively few upgrades and modifications. Nowadays, different kinds of filaments are available in different packaging, but the common between them is the coiled form. The most of well-known thermoplastics can be transformed to filaments, for example, ABS, PET, or nylon, or polycarbonate. There are some exotic filaments that are made of composites for extra requirements, for example, heat-resistant, electrical conductivity or non-conductivity, carrying an active ingredient, and so on. The most of the usable materials are petroleum derivatives, but there are some biodegradable alternatives of these materials mentioned above. For example, PLA is a plant-derived plastic with basically adequate plastic properties. At the end of this introduction, I would like to mention about some milestones of FDM printing. The earliest 3D printing technologies came about 1980s. The special 5 format, this is the STL5 format, in which the original surface of the object is approximated or tessellated with a triangular mesh. So this 5 format was established in 1983. So it is a very old 5 format, but it's actually usable. And all the story of fused deposition modeling started with the personal story of Scott Crump. He wanted to create a toy froggy for his 2-year-old daughter using a hot glue gun filled with a mixture of polyethylene and candle wax. As he created it manually, he saw a way how to automate this process, building 3D shape from series of layers placed on top of each other. In 1989, Scott Crump and his wife co-founded Stratasys Incorporation, which is one of the most prominent additive manufacturing companies in the world today. 2 years later, Scott created the first operational FDM printer in the brand of Stratasys. So here you can see the drawing or the plan of this device and the real operational version of this printer. In 2004, Adrian Brouwer, a senior lecturer in mechanical engineering at the University of Bath, founded a project with the name RepRop. It was an open source project which aimed to build a 3D printer that could print most of its own parts. The main goal of this project was to democratize 3D printing by making the technology available to people around the world. The friends could print 3D printers for their friends. The RepRop technology has a great potential in the educational applications as well. Some experts have claimed that the RepRops offer a revolution in STEM education. The evidence comes from low cost of rapid prototyping by students and the fabrication of low-cost, high-quality scientific equipment from open hardware designs. The STEM education means science, technology, engineering, and math together, and they reflect to each other, and this is the basic idea in project-based education methods. And now let's see some definite main lines, or two definite main lines of RepRops. The first will be the MakerBot Industries. This company was founded in 2009 in Brooklyn. MakerBot launched and helped bring 3D printing technology into mainstream. Building on the success of RepRaps, MakerBot made an open source do-it-yourself kit for people wanting to build their own 3D printers. In the beginning, all the designs or the documentations were open source. On the picture, you can see the founders of the company with their first printer. The name of this small 3D printer is Cupcake, MakerBot Cupcake. It was their first printer and the first product. And the 2012 was the key year in the life of company. They turned back on open source, and 1 year later, MakerBot was acquired by Stratasys, and the devices and any other solutions are currently being developed as a sub-brand of Stratasys. The target group and the customer segment were changed, and MakerBot is no more for regular hobbyists or individuals. They became open to industrial segment with plug-and-play solutions. In the late 2010 and early 2011, MakerBot was at the top of the world. At that time, the world was hungry for novelties of 3D printing, and the people followed MakerBot in good faith. No company could ever catch up, and the MakerBot was the new business model. Anyone could become rich and famous in the on the contributions of his user base by building open source hardware. It was their idea. With a large active community that was willing to develop improvements for hardware, no company could match the potential of MakerBot. Their aspirations to democratize 3D printing seems to be resolved. With open source hardware, 3D printing was a cure to MakerBot printing at that time. But 1 year later, conflicts have emerged among the founding members, and one of them left the company. And in the same year, an improved clone of MakerBot Replicator was realized on Kickstarter. Because the design files were open source, the creator just made it better, and some of errors became to be corrected in this TangiBot. Although the TangiBot Kickstarter did not succeed, MakerBot took this threat seriously and thought open source was a liability. In the next year, in 2013, Stratasys Incorporated acquired the MakerBot company, and the deal provided that MakerBot would operate as a distinct sub-brand of Stratasys, serving the consumer and desktop market segments. The number of employees was reduced between 2012 to 2017, nearly 500 employees was laid worldwide. Currently, they employ only nearly 200 workers. With the closed source designs, devices are not easily affordable for users' requirements. The wooden covers that were used in original look was turned to painted metal and plastics. So this new look is an elegant and sleek, and it is so close to the industrial requirements. And the inner solutions and the descriptions of the hardware designs are not publicly available anymore, and the changing that was that comes from the Stratasys, so they looks in not only the inner look of the printers. The solutions are closed, and the solutions are close to the idea. in which the user wants to push the knob and wait for the printing and not to be part of the process of understanding. In the February of 2016, MakerBot reached milestone of 100,000 3D printers sold worldwide. Up to this point, the production was in USA. Then revenues had to be increased. 3 months later, MakerBot laid off its entire manufacturing force, and outsourced the manufacturing of all MakerBot printers to China. The community were not happy with the changes. Against industry expectations, the 3D printing hobbyist community has different aspects and requirements. The first is the price of the devices and accessories. The look of the printers are elegant, complex, with a sleek look. With a, yes, it is a in our picture. So with a sleek look, and there is a dedicated places for the filament spools in these devices. Basically, it is commandable, but filaments of MakerBot brand have a unique spool size. All dimensions of the spools are different from commercial ones, and they cannot be replaced or not so easy to replace the filaments from other manufacturers. The often criticized part is the smart extruder of the MakerBot replicators. Basically, the extruder, the heated nozzle, is a essential part of any FDM printer, but MakerBot changed it to smart extruder with a filament sensor, and this compact extruder can attachable to the printer magnetically, and the price is an interesting in this story. Basically, the parts of this device cost around $50, but the price of the smart extruder is about five times that, so it is not so perfect solution, I think. And it is recommended to work nearly 400 hours and should be replaced afterwards. So hard to buy another and another smart extruder when we use or the users wants to use their MakerBot printers. And basically, the pricing of MakerBot is approaching to industrial prices anyway. Basically, MakerBot turned back on their initial principles and the individual customers as well. But there are some positive facts and effects of MakerBot. For example, the Thingiverse was launched a few months before founding MakerBot Industries, parallelly to their development work. This is an online file library repository to share, publish 3D design files, descriptions, and experiences. Thingiverse, which is definitely the universe of things, became the largest online 3D printing community and file repository in the world. So it is a positive, one of the positive effects. And the next is for the schools or for the education. The next initiative was launched under the wings of Stratasys. This project is to support education of next generations. The idea was that the company is ready to put 3D printers to any schools in USA. An educational program was developed involving experts, and whole package contained not only 3D printers. There are teaching materials for any level of education, guides, tutorials, trainings, and online seminars for teachers. 1 year later, this initiative was extended to Europe as well. Some representative schools and universities got an opportunity to be owner of MakerBot printer, and start to learn and teach 3D printing and modeling related to. My Faculty of Informatics in Debrecen was one of the winners of this competition. And we got MakerBot printer in 2016, and we start our version of this educational program. So it's a positive effect of MakerBot. And I will switch to another company that was the original aim of this lecture. This is the Prusa research, but later I will refer back to the other company. The founder, Josef Prusa, is a 31-year-old man who always interested interested in technology, but much more computers and programming than anything else. Okay. His experience with 3D printing began while he was a student at the University of Economics in Prague. He had a lot of free time, and he and his brother started to get into DJing. He wanted to build better music controllers, so he turned to 3D printing to do so. This led him to the Repra project, and Josef had a dilemma, buying a tablet or buying a 3D printer. And it was solved, so finally the 3D printer was chosen, and he started to 3D printing with Reflap Mandel. I show it. This Mandel was the second printer in the Reprap project. Prusa ended up improving the design, and during this create Prusa Simplify Mandel, easy to assemble, repair and modify. It opened the world of 3D printing to wide audience. 2 years later, the third iteration of Mandel was realized. It was a complete redesign that brought a new frame, dozens of upgrades, and a special Prusa nozzle. Studies at the university did not provide enough time dealing with 3D printers. The development of the printers seems quite promising, so Prusa stopped his university studies to focus full time on 3D printing. And in 2012, the Prusa Research was founded as a one-man startup company. Their first product was the third iteration of Mandel printer that became known as the original Prusa E3. And this type of printers was improved many times later. If you check this timeline, there are three similar printer. The original Prusa E3 MK3, this is in the middle. This printer is the most popular machine with the optional multi-material unit. And the original Prusa Mini is a smaller and more affordable version of MK3. And the company offer own brand products, including its own filament, Prusament, that was introduced in 2018. And the youngest member in this printer family is the resin printer of them with an optional curing and washing machine. In this other technology, the printing material is a liquid material, is a resin, and UV lights helps the hardening of the layers. Prusa Research was founded as a one-man company. It is difficult to talk about the company without talking about Prusa, the man. He is mainly the company, exactly the driving force in the company, specialist expert, and the public face in the same person. he understands all the principles of all developments, and he always up to date in 3D printing world and responds well to the changes of 3D printing world. He always considered it is important to be part of the community. It is very important to have an instant feedback from the people. He saw that it is important in each individual field to hire people who are much better than he. And this precept is pushing the company forward, but keeps knowledge of all the basics and all of the fields. Joseph resent companies that only use RepRap results, but they are not give back to the project. He has a personal mission to have RepRap as a best printer. This is a question, did he succeed? The answer is yes. If you check these awards, there are different kind of awards. The company get different categories in different years, like best desktop printers, best open source printers, best kits, generally the best resin printers, and so on, by prestigious professional portals. Their products have been proven. And now let's see some facts about the advancement of Prusa Research. The company was the third fastest growing tech company in the region, Europe, Middle East and Africa together. Between 2040 and 2070, I think it is an interesting number. Their growing rate is more than 70,000% in this 4 years. So I think it's very large, and for me it is incredible. And the company was the third fastest growing. Yes, it was a company. Yes. By the end of this period, Prusa E3 design was officially the most used FDM printer around the world. And shortly, I would like to overview some social effects of the company. Developing the company has outgrown its factory or building in several times. Their current building is a very large building with 9 floors. This building is for development and manufacturing in Prague. 3 years ago, a fully equipped community makerspace, hacker space, was opened here in the ground floor. This place is dedicated to prototyping and inventing, starting from 3D designing, 3D modeling, printing, CNC milling, mechanic building, electrical lab, or sewing, so there are different kind of activities. Actually, the lab is closed now, but they regularly hold creative workshops and trainings here. And the next is the community hub. This prusaprinters.org site was created or launched in 2013 originally, but it has been relaunched as a brand new solution with online model library, world map of users, groups, community activities, challenges, ready to print G codes, and much more. As a successful company, it provides support to Czech Republic in various fields. Last year, Prusa Research started their educational support. Earlier, some 3D printers were put to educational institutions as well, but the aim of the program Prusa Pruškoli is to provide various institutions with discounted Prusa printers, filaments, resources for teachers, pre-made exercises, specific ideas on what to do with 3D printer in school. The groups of students and classes are also welcome for study trips to the Prusa Lab. The year 2020 was unusual for many of companies. However, despite the new challenges, or maybe because of them, the 3D printing community grew ever bigger and more active. And it was amazing to see people coming together and helping each other. It was a hectic year, but I think the number reflects the results. They have managed to ship more than 100,000 3D printers, over 500 tons of Prusament, and hundreds of thousands of small orders like upgrades, spare parts or accessories. And they have used nearly 600 3D printers at the farm to create the new generation of their 3D printers. Dedicated members of staff were more than 600. They launched different upgrades for printers, introduced different printing materials, and updated their own slicing software. This is a special software preparing the 3D models to G-codes. Prusa Research did not forget about the community. They are active on its websites and on Facebook and on YouTube and on Instagram and on Pinterest and Twitter, and their Discord channel was established as well. Actually, they use 9 different languages to make communication easier. Instead of a real events that failed due to pandemic, social involvement also played an important role. They designed an open source Prusa face shield. And with the help of their community, they produced over 250,000 face shields, which they donated to frontline medic staff in Czech Republic. And there are probably millions of 3D printed shields still used all over the world. And let's see some secrets of this company. I think not only money in their treasure chest. Josef Prusa has a long-term vision. The active community help him find new ideas and areas to focus on. The printers are assembled from properly selected high-quality components, and the products are affordable for usual user and can easily be upgraded later. The production is in Czech Republic, creating domestic job statuses. They have amazing customer support, and the news spreads by the word of mouth. Prusa printers have different clones around the world, but the quality of them is often inappropriate, and these printers are usually improved with the original Prusa parts. So basically, every part leads to Prusa. All the work and strategy bore its fruits, and Josef was awarded as Czech Entrepreneur of the Year 2020. Josef is a real superstar in 3D printing. Prusa called his role, he's a glue that holds all people together, and he sets the path of the company, furthers the popularization of 3D printing, cares for community, consults with people, and still comes up with new ideas for what printers should do. He plans to improve their resin printer and some parts of FDM printers, like motors. In the future, he wants to decouple their work from external factors and bring together every moment of production in one hand. They want to try to be not dependent on their suppliers. He examines the possibility how to collect back 3D printing waste, and he wants, or they want, to recycle them and produce useful things from them by molding or creating their own recycled filament. I prepared the common timeline for companies mentioned above, noted their main milestones. Not to forget, MakerBot was an innovative startup based on RepRap philosophy at the beginning, but now it is a distinct sub-brand of one of the most dominant additive manufacturing companies, and the wool production is in China. Most of the stuff was laid, and the user base is also declining, but the umbrella of Stratasys can help survive the critic period and can show the new guidelines for MakerBot industries. Krusta Research was founded as a one-man startup, and 9 years after its founding, it is one of the fastest growing companies in Central Europe. Their user base is professional critics are praising the work related to. The company cooperates with their users, and the active community keep the company on the top. In these times, a lot of startups are built for fast growing and selling them. Yusuf has no plans on selling the company or quitting. Building Prusa Research is for long term, and they keep the possibility of passing into their children. The companies that were presented here had a similar initial ideas, but their founding was in different period in 3D printing development. Made MakerBot to be successful, but the company left them alone. Prusa Research is a much luckier and more flexible company, and it is expected it can keep current role in additive manufacturing life. And there are references for the MakerBot industries in the first slide of these references, and there are another group of my links. They are connected to Prusa Research. And thank you for your very kind attention.